you know, we're trying, you know. They had a message that was like, you know, never surrender, fight the good fight, hold on to your dreams, you know. And I'm proud of that. I think that's a great legacy that the band has, that we were a band of motivation and inspiration.
I think you got a choice of how you live your life, and I don't, you know, bear grudges, and I don't let those kind of feelings, you know, cloud my perspective on what happened overall, and I feel really good about Triumph.
Every little thing we did was, even something minor, was all, it was a great achievement, and, you know, just felt lucky enough that you got to live your dream.
You're watching the story of Triumph. Now, this is the story of three friends that took their brand of Canadian hard rock music to the international stage. But after the rise was the fall, when the art was taken over by business, and those three friendships dissolved. Tonight, for the first time since 1988, Triumph members Rick Emmett, Mike Levine, and Gil Moore talk openly and freely about the story of Triumph.
The first time I ever saw live drums, it just blew my mind. It was up in Port Elgin at the casino, which subsequently burned down, but I saw this band called the Comets, and I was in the audience, and I don't even think I was old enough to get into to whatever it was, this you know, beach dance, and got up close to the stage, saw a guy hitting these drums that had that red sparkle finish, and it just looked like, wow, what could be better than that, hitting those things. And it was like a trance I went into. I just sat there and watched him for the whole show. And that was it, I was hooked.
I was pretty naive when it all started. The other two guys already had something up and rolling that they were looking for somebody to come in and sort of function as a front man. Who's going to come and front this thing and you know, write songs and be the guy? But they had this vision of a three-piece pyrotechnical, you know, extravaganza kind of rock band. And they already had a little bit of a recording deal thing happening with Attic Records. And I think that was Mike's connection there into the record business. And Gil already had, you know, a little PA business. So we already had gigantic PA stuff because his garage was full of PA stuff. He was renting it to all the local Mississauga bands in his neighborhood and stuff. So they already had stuff up and running.
It was just what you wanted to do, and, you know, making a living at it didn't really enter into the equation. Remaining gainfully unemployed has been something I've done my whole life.
We hadn't planned it, and it just happened. So for, you know, Rick and I were able to play off each other a lot. You know, we just get together and go, let's try this, you know, and leave Gil in the dark, and he'd have to try and catch up with us. Or we'd have to try and catch up with him, depending. But, yeah, it was always amazing. You know, it was amazing to me that we were able to make that many records and play that many concerts and be able to please that many people. I mean, that's the ultimate goal, is you don't do it for yourself, you do it for the public.
It was all a pleasant surprise in the initial stages. As the band got off the ground, it was good, it was solid, and it was very positive. It started well, and then we went through a little period where I wasn't sure. And we'd been making the records and things were going good, but we'd sort of overextended ourselves a little bit, and were we gonna get a US deal or not? And then when that landed and that sort of happened, then it just, it was all very positive, and I was pleasantly surprised again for a long period of time.
When you and Mike first started Triumph, did you ever believe it would become this big?
Yes. We had a lot of confidence in what we were doing. We believed in it, believed in each other. Well, we didn't believe it until we got Rick.
That we're going to do all right because we always give 100% when we play live, and we always make the best records that we can instead of relying on some sort of a reputation or something like that.
I realized after two or three tunes, when we played our very, very first show, we played at a high school in Simcoe, Ontario, and it was instant. It was just absolutely instantaneous. The response to the band was really good, and it was like nothing I'd ever seen before. And it was funny because when I looked at Mike's bands, Rick's bands, my bands, none of them really had a good, you know, good feedback. But for whatever reason, the three of us together, just something clicked.
When you guys were down in Pittsburgh recently, you had the number one record there for 5 weeks.
It was pretty crazy. It was a lot of little girls in the hotel lobby and people climbing on the cars and drove away from the venue and stuff like that. It was kind of crazy.
You guys at the point now where you can walk down the street and say, hey, you're from Triumph, I know you.
Some places we can't walk down the street.
The very first sort of inroads laid was in Texas for this band.
Yeah, Texas was really our first, San Antonio in particular, was the first place that we really broke in America.
It was fascinating. We thought, how could somebody like us that far away? How did they find out about us? How did they hear about us? It was the start of a tornado.
These radio guys in San Antonio started playing it, you know, in the midnight radio show or whatever, and we were getting airplay, and then they were getting great phones. People loved it.
And the record company started exporting records into the market, and pretty soon we were a big item in that town.
What happened there was, I think it was Sammy Hagar, I'm not sure, but somebody was supposed to be doing a show at the Municipal Auditorium in San Antonio, and they got sick, and they couldn't do it. And it was like this last-minute call.
So they phoned us and asked if we would headline. And we're going, oh, yeah, sure, you know, that's really easy to do. We were not prepared at all to be able to do that, but kind of sucked our guts in and said, let's go do it.
We stepped into this thing that was like really sort of American rock and roll vibe.
We sold out San Antonio Municipal Auditorium. And the fans went nuts. It was like crazy. It was there. And then we knew we had something special.
But with us, it seemed like as soon as we got in the United States, not only were we accepted down there right away, but it seemed to have a lot of impact back here in Canada.
We were really great friends in the band. I mean, it's not like we were, some bands that just hate each other all the way through. And, you know, we toured with a lot of bands that would be like that. You know, I can remember having UFO as our opening act for a long time. And it was funny because we thought these guys would kill each other by the end of the tour. There were so many fights going on backstage. It was amazing. And, you know, we were just never like that.
It's like we're the Three Musketeers, you know, one for all for one. And that's how we started the band, and that's how we continued on.
The three of us working as a sort of a cohesive unit, like a family almost. And every album that we make, that sense of family grows too, you know. It's you really feel the team thing.
And Triumph's always been a team. And so when we go in to make records, it's the same thing.
There's lots of stuff that I feel good about. In that whole heavy metal genre, we were the good guys. We were the band in white. you know. So, you know, here's Ozzy and here's Judas Priest and there's, you know, they're leather and studs and, you know, and the Scorpions and even Van Halen, they were, there was a little bit of debauchery going on there, you know. And,
just a little.
Yeah, you know. But here with Triumph, you know, they had a message that was like, you know, never surrender, fight the good fight, hold on to your dreams, you know. And I'm proud of that. I think that's a great legacy that the band has, that we were a band of motivation and inspiration.
A lot of writers and people in the media have seen, you know, the positive aspects to some of the lyrics that we've written over the years, and so they sort of placed us as the flip side of the coin to that whole devil worship thing.
Wonderful Crew, most of their songs are about hope, they aren't about nonsense, they are not the typical, quote, heavy metal band, they are far beyond that barrier, that's what makes them different.
A lot of people pointed to Triumph as being a heavy metal band, but you weren't in terms of what other bands that were being called heavy metal musically were doing. Was that frustrating at all?
Not at all. As long as they said nice things about us, you know. The media always had to buttonhole you into some area, you know. So we play with it. We had a publicist who created the word precious metal to get around the heavy metal, you know. So they were fine. It's pretty hokey. It was pretty, well, how would you describe your band? You go, precious metal. Oh, jeez, it was hard to say. It looked good in print, but it was hard to say. Well, you know, we had some pop elements and had some incredibly heavy elements too. So we were like a broad spectrum. So it because heavy metal was the hip thing, not hip thing, but I guess it was, that was the only word, or I mean, Journey was a heavy metal band too.
We've never been like a Judas Priest or a Motorhead or an Iron Maiden. We've been a heavy rock act, and we have had a spectacular stage show that we've toured with, and so that makes people think, that they're in there with all the rest of those metal maniacs.
Heavy metal was you know, the start of branding, you know. Before that, I don't think people branded music as much as they do now. You know, we never called ourselves heavy metal, and I thought it was kind of a vague term. Like, I sort of thought of Judas Priest as being heavy metal, you know? That's the way I looked at it. But we didn't really care what people called us, you know, as long as they paid attention, so.
Both Mike and Gil had a perception, a vision, that was a very hard rock, this is what we're going to do. And when we first started out, we were playing, you know, high schools in Ontario, you know, a scene that doesn't even exist anymore. But in those days, you could play two or three nights a week high school concerts, you know, literally going into the gym and doing your thing. And we started out playing sort of Led Zeppelin, Deep Purple. We had sets, like medleys, you know, 8 or 9 songs, you know. So Led Zeppelin sets, Deep Purple, we had a Jimi Hendrix thing, you know, so that was the roots of Triumph. That's where we started out playing that kind of copy material. So when we started writing, the material sort of headed in that direction. It was a very sort of Zeppelin-esque kind of band.
Straightforward rock and roll is what Triumph has built its base on, and I think that that'll always be an essential part of what Triumph does. As to what is very popular and, you know, whether we're going to conform to it, I think not. I think that what we pursue as artists is trying to play the kind of music that pleases us the best and gives us the most challenge.
A lot of other bands at that time were killing themselves, but that was never part of Triumph's world.
No, we were, you know, I guess we were a clean band, for lack of a better word. We didn't, you know, we didn't stay on the road for extended periods of time. It kept, you know, some sanity around it. It's not like you're locked on a tour bus and you got a night off, or you're just driven yourself into, I got to do something to get rid of the tension or the grief or the aggravation or the fun, whatever it might be. So I think we're pretty lucky that way, but we always try to take care of ourselves, you know. Not that we didn't, you know, get some damage bills here and there, but there was no brain damage per se.
If anyone was going to die in Triumph, it probably should have been me, because drummers seem to have a penchant for wanting to do themselves in, but I never really shared that sentiment. You know, I always wanted to live to see my kids grow up, so.
There was a lot of comparisons to another three-piece band out of Toronto at that time. Having to get through that, was it a bit of a hassle?
That was great. Because, you know, Rush preceded us by 4 or 5 years, and they broke a lot of ground that we could just kind of, they opened the door, you know, by a crack, and we were able to just smash right through it. So we learned a lot from their experiences. I thank them for breaking the ground first, because it's not easy ground.
I really, truly believe that Rush had coattails that we were able to ride on. And, you know, I've always openly said that and admitted that, and I've always been grateful.
Was there a rivalry at all?
I think that was a media thing, you know. I mean, really, we had two distinct news. The only comparison, we're from Toronto, and we're three-piece bands. But I think the comparison kind of stops there.
A lot of the same fans crossed over between the two bands, because when you were backstage and you'd be signing autographs with kids, you know, they'd be saying, oh, I like Rush, you guys from Toronto, they sort of identified us as being three-piece, being from Toronto, and so we got kind of lumped together with Rush for that reason. And I always thought it was a compliment, because I always like Rush. And I always thought they were good, and they had the respect of the fans, and they really helped us. So there's no competition.
How do you guys go about creating a song and putting it down in on an album? From start to finish.
First we order a large pizza. Then we eat it, and then we write lyrics.
Like Rick comes up with whatever he's gonna come up with, and I come up with whatever I'm gonna come up with, and Mike comes up with whatever he can come up with, and then we get together and pool our ideas and run the songs down, you know, for each other, and talk about the concepts for the record, and then when we start rehearsing, we sort the grain from the chaff.
For me as a writer, and as a musician, I'm more inclined to pick up an acoustic guitar and start writing folk songs, jazz songs, you know, whatever. I don't limit myself, and I never have. And my own personal tastes came from an era that was more, yes, King Crimson. So here I was now in this other kind of band that had this other kind of vision. So the material would keep getting pushed every now and then in other areas and other directions.
We go downstairs into Gil's basement and rehearse, and we all fight and yell and scream at each other for so long.
That's the part I like.
And then later on in the band's sort of history, as we were making records, I'd write all kinds of stuff, but the other guys kind of, you know, they said, no, you know, we want this, or they'd take a piece of material and they'd say, we have to make it heavier. And at the heart of what Triumph was, it did have this sort of schizoid personality thing. It was originally conceived as a hard rock band, and when you're a trio, it's very hard to get sort of esoteric and, you know, artistically, musically. There definitely was a sort of a schizoid thing that existed there, and in the end, I guess that was one of the things that sort of cleaved it apart, as it were. That was one of the things, in the end, why I chafed so much inside the whole Triumph thing. You know, you're in that machine, and that machine can only be one kind of thing. You can't make it be two or three or four or five different kinds of things. And I really hated that. And it made me unhappy as an artist, as a writer, as a player, as a recording artist, all of those kinds of things, however you define all of those labels, you know. So in the end, it was a question of having to get out of that shoebox.
You influence people's lives. How often do any of us get an opportunity to do that, you know? It's like, to me, this whole thing is totally mind-blowing what we were able to. At the time, you didn't even think about it. But when you look back on it now, you go, wow, you know, we did all that. And we get a fan letter and, you know, somebody listened to a song. They were going to commit suicide, and the song gave them new hope. And they ended up doing whatever they did with their lives. And you go, man. Like this, you know, the respect that you should have for the power, all us, every musician, every entertainer should always respect that, you know, and never abuse it. Did I just say that?
Oh, that's beautiful.
Making music has always been the most important thing to me. And it was more important than the haircut that I had, or the video that I was going to make, or the, you know, the business deal I was going to have. I knew that all those things were important. It's not like I don't even use a little hairspray from time to time, you know. But I understand about show business. But I was never going to put show business ahead of trying to make good music, make good records, and be humble in the process of writing and singing and playing my guitar. So, if you want to call that integrity, okay. I think it was Gil's sort of plan that once we had the deal with RCA in the States, that we would try and use tour support and build up our own little sound and lights thing, so that when we were playing a gig in a place like Cleveland, the promoter wasn't having to pay, you know, however many thousands of show costs to an SNL company. We were going to get the sound and lights money. We were going to bring our rig in, and we were going to get sound and lights money. So that was a brilliant plan. Even though we were playing small places, we go and we play the small theater, and we do a small house. People go, you know, the next day, the word of mouth, they go, you should have seen this band.
It was about the show.
Yeah, they had, you know, they blew off, you know, flash pots, and they had lights all over everything, and my God, it's unbelievable. You gotta see Triumph.
You know, we wanted to have a good show or a great show. We wanted to do things other people didn't do. We always looked at music as the live part of making music, as being entertainment. And entertainment value, you know, in those days was not the greatest in the world. You know, bands would go out with, you know, 50 lights kind of, and think they were putting on a great show. And, you know, I was one that, you know, I loved going to Vegas and seeing the shows there, because they were just had everything in them, you know. And we tried to incorporate as new technology came out, excuse me, and we could afford to use it on stage. You know, we'd try and incorporate it if we could, you know. And Gil was great at putting all that stuff together.
We really felt that the live performance was, you know, a bonding thing with the audience, where the more excited they got, the more excited we got. So if we played a show and there wasn't a real strong response from the audience, we didn't consider they were being polite. We considered they were being bored. So we really tried to make the live shows like a real intense, fired up, emotional, sweat, guts, and the whole ball of wax. Just,
you know, we never had the classic hit record that went to the, you know, to the top 10, and as a result, you know, we gained a lot of popularity. Ours was very slow, and it was based on live concerts. So without doing this, never would have happened.
1, 2, 3, 5. 1, 2, 3, 5.
Rock and roll is people's music. And a record company can create whatever they want and say, this is the people's music. Or radio can say, this is the people's music. But the people will decide what the people's music is.
And when the lights go down, it's all the same.
When the lights go down, what can I tell you?
You hear it, you feel it sometimes. And there are those moments where everybody flicks a bit. And, you know, I can remember moments like where you just see those lighters all the way up to the rafters. And that's a phenomenal moment. But generally speaking, you know, it's neater to be playing something or singing something and you look up and you can actually see into people's eyes. That's a good thing.
We started playing live, and everything we did was spawned from playing live. We would play, people would respond to us, then people would buy our records. People would, call the radio station or whatever. But it was never the other way around. We weren't like a flash in the pan hit single. Boom, these guys are big, where do they come from? It was always very, very gradual, you know, and it was all based around live performing.
What did you get out of it, that stage performance?
I was the best. That was the culmination of a day of travel, checking in hotels, going to a couple of radio interviews, going to sound check, and then coming back to the hotel and getting to relax and watch Wheel of Fortune and Jeopardy, and then go back to the gig and play, which was the culmination of the day, which is the only reason the day existed. You'd spend 10 hours to get to that 90 minutes, and that 90 minutes had better be good. You know, otherwise, what are you doing it for? But, you know, when the house lights went dark and everybody lit a candle or a match or a lighter, it just buzzed, you know, just buzzed. And we had one of the best intros in rock and roll, so the place was rocking before we even hit the stage.
Please give a rock and roll welcome for Trent!
I'm walking out, and it's just like the adrenaline would flow. You have to calm down now. You still got 90 minutes to go.
You really miss those days, don't you?
I once was quoted as better than sex. My wife didn't talk to me for months after. But it was, you know, those were fabulous times and fabulous moments, you know, things you'll never forget.
If you look back to bands that started in the 70s, it was a lot harder to get your message out. You know, there was no much music. There was no much more music. There was no MTV. It was go play for the people.
When Triumph started, there was no MTV. The business was a totally different business. And then we became one of the first darling bands of MTV only because we were one of the only ones that had videos. We, you know, put a couple of, you know, and this was Mike's vision, a good one, that we should have songs and we should have videos.
Decided that it was time to really put the emphasis in our direction on the United States because we wanted to break the United States. You know, we wanted to end up on the US Festival. We didn't want to be a band that couldn't be on the US Festival. We wanted to be on the US Festival. The only way to do that was to be big in Florida, big in Wyoming, big in Oregon, big in Texas, big in New Jersey. And the only way to do that is you got to play all those markets and meet all those people.
Obviously, it's worked because you're playing the US Festival
this
month.
Great show to play on. It was a neat thing to do. Oh, wow, that's amazing. I mean, how did we ever get so lucky? For me, it was like every little thing we did was, even something minor, was a great achievement. And, you know, just felt lucky enough that you got to live your dream. AC/DC was opening for us, and they weren't too happy about that.
Do you want the whole story? Well, listen, the story starts in Dallas a few weeks prior, because after the show, there was a young lady who, I guess we'll call her an exotic dancer, who had eyes and designs on yours truly, God knows why. And I had sort of not really been open to these advances. And so, 2 weeks pass. We're playing in St. Louis.
And we were playing the Checkerdome in St. Louis, and they were opening for us.
I'm in my dressing room, and Bon Scott comes shuffling in. And I say shuffle because he's wearing those plastic kind of thong shoes, you know, and he's obviously stepped on a broken beer bottle or something, because his foot is all taped up and it's still bleeding through the bandage.
And sort of drunk out of his mind, you know, threatening to kill Rick, came barging in the dressing room.
And I go, Bon, how you doing, man? Nice to meet you. And I sort of offer my hand, and he goes, oh, I don't think I should shut your end, man. I don't think I'll punch your nose out. And I said, what are you talking about, man? And he goes, oh, I heard you don't like my band, man. I heard you think my band sucks, man. You think my band's shit, man. I think I would have fucking fill you in. And I'm going, Bon, where's this coming from, man? I don't know what you're talking about. And I look over his shoulder, and I can see out the door and down the hall, who's peeking around the corner but that stripper from Dallas? And and right away, I can put it together. She would love to see me get in a lot of trouble because I wasn't very nice to her a couple of weeks ago back in Dallas. She's hooked up with Bon. He's got her out on the road with her now. She's filled his head with all kinds of stuff. And I go, oh, Bon. I go, look, man, are you going to take the word of some strumpet, some, you know, thing that you've met out on the road? Or are you going to take the word of a fellow musician that, believe me, I love you, man, don't, whatever she's been filling your head with, man, that, there's nothing to that. Let me buy you a beer. And I go over to the, you know, and pull a cold beer out of the thing, and, you know, and it's like, all right, okay, man. But we've all got beers, and we're all happy, and we're all brothers, and we're all, you know, so I didn't get beat up by Bon, but it was close.
Bands that will be successful are the bands that have the best players and write the best tunes and make the best records and put on the best shows. And if I didn't believe that, I wouldn't do it. You know, I wouldn't be involved in it.
You know, there's a time for everything. I guess it's just one of those things that happened. Hard to describe. I don't know exactly why. It wasn't just one particular thing. Maybe it was 15 years of, or 14 years, whatever it was, of trying to put up with each other. But it's, you know, things happen.
Initially, you start a rock band, and you haven't got a pot to whittle in. So, you know, everybody's willing to make any kind of compromise, any kind of sacrifice in order to get it rolling. That's not to say that there aren't inherent problems, you know, but everybody's willing to overlook them as you try and get some success. And then once you get success, success is great because it can hide a lot of things. You know, if you've got a lot of money or you've got a lot of stuff to keep you busy, it can hide a lot of problems too, or you know, you put them on the back burner. But that's not to say that there weren't sort of peas under the mattress that were there right from the beginning. You know, in the initial stages, I'd say, guys, you know, we're going to have to really do a lot of rehearsing. We're going to have to do a lot of rehearsing. And they weren't keen on it. I kind of was always the guy that was sort of saying, hey, I'd really like to spend more time collaborating, writing together. Let's spend some more time rehearsing. You know, let's get in the woodshed together and see if we can't get something happening. And they'd go, yeah. You know, so that was a big one for me, and it never really solved itself. The more successful the band got, the more time those guys were, you know, on the phone and doing things and making deals, and they were busy. So it seems small-minded to make it. Now that it's on tape, it's going to seem horrible, but, you know, it was just a thing. There were lots of things. I'm sure they have a million of about me, so.
You know, so what? You know, if you want to be like that, if you want to be, you know, partners with somebody and friends with somebody, and then you get pissed off and you have a fight, obviously there's fault on both sides when something like that happens. Like, I'm probably as angry as him, or was as angry at him. I'm not now. I'm not angry at him at all, but you get over things.
So the truth of the matter was that the band was, towards the end, was general managed by Gil. It's his baby, you know, and he was the general manager. And Mike was kind of like the promotion record company guy, marketing guy, you know. And Rick was kind of like, you go into the studio and, you know, make product. You deliver us what we can turn into product. So that was kind of how the responsibilities broke out. As it was, after the roller coaster got to the top of a hill and then was heading down a little bit, and in those times, I'd say, geez, guys, you know, I'm a little frustrated. I'd really like to make a solo record. I'd really like to try and break out of this little shell, you know. And they weren't keen on that.
He sure did want to go out and do his own thing. I mean, that's what his whole intention was. And like I said, I think he got tired of the pressure from the record company and the sameness of it. I mean, we'd been doing the same thing for a long time. Some bands keep going forever. I think he thought, you know, I can make records on my own. I can do music that I want to do that's, you know, different than conforming to a band's sort of parameters. Every band has some kind of parameters.
There was a lot of stuff that was going on leading up to the point of, you know, that last show, September of 88, my swan song.
There was an agreement a long time ago made between the three of you that as soon as it wasn't fun anymore, you'd call it quits. Everyone agreed to that.
Yep.
Why was it so shocking to them when one of you said, it's not fun anymore, let's call it quits?
Well, it's a complicated thing, Bill. You know, you've got contracts that exist, and you've got debts that exist, and you've got all, you know, there's lots and lots of money and value and assets and things. You know, there was a studio sitting there that we were partners in, and there'd been this sort of very kind of unhappy thing that had gone on where Gil bought Mike out of his share and then bought me out of mine, and it was a sort of a take it or leave it kind of scenario, and I was really unhappy about that. So in the wake of that, now I'm thinking about leaving and I'm trying to work out how will I get out of this. There were all of these things that were sitting there, you know, cooking in pots on the stove. And what do you do? You know, so it was going to be very, very complicated trying to extricate myself as a partner from that partnership that existed. And I knew I had a real strong gut feeling that it wouldn't be easy. And I had a handshake deal that was, hey, you know, as long as I get my paycheck from playing these gigs, I'll stick around and play as many gigs as you need for me to help you pay off your debts. But I want my share of those gigs. I'm not going to help you pay off your debts and walk away from, give you a debt-free triumph, thank you very much. No, you know. And I never got a nickel from playing those gigs, like that Kingswood gig, and the, you know, when we played Puerto Rico, when we played South Padre Island, and we played a gig in San Francisco. I never got any money.
Neither did I, neither did Mike. Normal Triumph Tour was maybe 60 or 70 shows and would take most of a year, and there'd be a lot of money at the end. In 88, I think we played a grand total of 5 shows and tried to support our whole organization off that kind of income structure. So there was nothing there at the end of the tour. Rick knows that. For 10 years, I've been listening to Rick Badmouth, Mike and I, and you know, the truth of the matter is, I tried to settle everything peacefully with Rick. I went over to his house on numerous occasions and tried to speak to him mano a mano. And he's the one that provoked the litigation, hired the lawyers, and he took his best shot in court. And he's angry because he didn't win. And that's what this is all about. It's all about sour grapes.
That was another thing where I went, oh, here's another dagger in my back. Okay, sorry, see you later. But by doing that and leaving, that it was like now it was war. And they decided, not going to be any prisoners here, not going to be, it's going to be scorched earth. And I have scar tissue.
You know, he wanted to go in a different direction. And if you listen to his solo records, I mean, he did go in a very different direction. And he got to do what he wanted to do.
When you're in a band, it's like a democracy thing. And, you know, you sit down and you discuss things, and it comes to a vote, and I lost a lot of votes towards the end, and I was kind of thinking, no, it's time for me to turn into
a tyrant. Yeah, it's time for me to be a tyrant.
That's the big difference. It's kind of like now the bottom line for everything is me. And that takes some adjusting. And sometimes people it might say, well, that works to the detriment of your product. But, you know, I don't like to think of it as product so much. I like to think of it as music, and, you know, that's sort of where I come from. When I left Triumph, there was an element there of expectations. You know, oh, you're a rock guy, you better give us a rock record. Wow, you know, geez, you know, maybe that's not exactly what I want to do. And I was carrying the weight of the expectations of the guy that used to play in Triumph. But the business was changing so rapidly. You know, the whole advent of the Seattle grunge thing had really changed the landscape so much. And I wasn't getting any younger either. And there's an aspect of this business, and I, you know, I hate to break it to you, Bill, but, you know, it's about young folks, you know, young people, and you got to look good, and you got to stay looking young, and you got to be making records for young people to buy. That was kind of working against me, too. And so you sit back, and you look at all of that, and you go, where am I going with all of this? What's going to happen? What am I going to do when I'm 50? What am I going to do when I'm 55?
I love the studio business, and that's how, you know, Metalworks became sort of the, you know, the cornerstone in what I wanted to do with my future. You know, it was built, you know, essentially by Triumph for Triumph when it started in its first incarnation. And so it got off to a good start as a studio. We've done some movie stuff. We just had Denise Richards here last week. We did some stuff with Steven Seagal. A lot of the big pop stuff. NSYNC was here this year for quite a while. Tina Turner was here. That was a thrill having her here. Over the years, we've had the Cranberries. We've had David Bowie. We've had McFleetwood here. We've had a real kind of who's who of the music world come through the doors at one time or another.
It's like a divorce, you know, and unfortunately there's always bitterness in however a divorce goes. Show me a smooth divorce, I mean, they don't happen. And I guess this was, you know, just yet another divorce, and it's just a series of divorces, but, you know, in 9 out of 10 cases, the divorce parties end up being very good friends by the end of the day, so maybe just the day hasn't come.
Still get fan mail, still get all kinds of people saying, you know, well, you should get back together, you should do this, you should do that.
You must get asked the reunion question a lot then.
It's never ending. So, that's where it starts. I see someone I haven't seen in a while, like at Canadian Music Week. A lot of American guys were up here that I haven't seen in a while, and I go, so? And I go, so? So?
How many times a year do you get the reunion question?
Oh, about once a day.
Yeah, and so do I. But, and then I'm getting asked again, I think. I mean, I just, it ended, like I said, it ended so poorly. And there was so much blood, you know, that soaked into the ground that it's hard for me to imagine that I could get past it, or even that they could get past it.
And there were some hard feelings when he left. Probably always will be some hard feelings, but I think you got a choice of how you live your life. And I don't, you know, bear grudges, and I don't let those kind of feelings, you know, cloud my perspective on what happened overall. And I feel really good about Triumph.
We went out on top. You know, our last tour was a sold-out tour throughout North America. And you know, we didn't digress into the, or degenerate into, you know, an ugly bar band scene of, you know, a band that's, you know, finished.
Does it hurt you or surprise you that for 10 years there's been extremely little contact other than just through second parties and lawyers?
You know, I haven't tried to cut off any communication with Rick. Mike and I are good friends, and we always have been.
The emotional attachment we had, and the friendship we had, and the fun we had, you know, that's you miss a lot of that as time goes by. And it, you know, it would be fun to just get together. Like Gil and I see a lot of each other, not enough, but you know, we're still good friends.
I think I might have had a couple of conversations with Gil in '89, but they didn't go well. I hope if he sees that, he'll laugh too. You know, that, no, it didn't go well. And he's tried to call a couple of times more recently too, but I, you know, it ended so poorly in the end that there's just really not much point.
Yeah, I certainly miss Rick. You know, he was a really good friend, and you know, life is what it turns out to be. And you know, the book hasn't been closed yet.
You just never know how things are going to turn out. You can't predict the future.
I did some shows with the guys from Nazareth. You know, these guys, these Scottish guys that had just been this rock band all their lives. They didn't know how to do anything else except be Nazareth. When I saw those guys together, I really felt a twinge of regret that, you know, here they had their little club and they kept it going, and it was still there for them, you know. And I felt badly about that, that I wished that there had been...
You know, you never say never. Anything is possible.
You talk about, you know, water under the bridge. Well, the water went under the bridge, and then the riverbed dried right up, and then it cracked, and it turned into rock, and it fossilized. And I mean, it took a long, long, long time to get any kind of resolution of anything. So it just seems, I never say never. I just, it's really hard for me to imagine that it could happen, you know. But who knows?